Oh, yes.
Oh, it was.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely.
And somebody like C.G., who was he based on?
Well, you know, I had done a lot of research about artists for Shanghai Girls, mm-hmm. and what those artists were like in the 1930s. These artists who had created this whole beautiful girl phenomenon, yeah. with their advertising posters and these kind of calendar girls.
Yeah.
And many of those artists later were sort of moved from that kind of advertising mm-hmm. art into propaganda art.
Yeah.
And, you know, really, if you think about it, there isn't a big difference between selling yeah. cosmetics and selling
Mao,
you know, really. I mean, or some government program.
Yeah.
And so I had done research about what had happened to a lot of those
yeah.
artists as they made this transition. And then there's just one other part about C.G., and this is something that my mom said. You know, he's a little bit enigmatic, he's a little bit cryptic, he's a little bit hard to know, he's a little bit distant. And my mom called, when she read the book, she called my sister and she said, I just don't understand why, you know, how Lisa came up with a father who'd be so like that. You know, it's kind of hard to know, and all, you know, a little bit cryptic. And my sister said, do you remember who you married?
Yeah. Oh, that's wonderful. As well as, can we talk about Chief Cook?
Mm.
That when Pearl goes back to her home, her room is the same, but everybody has taken a different role.
Right.
But he still, after he makes her sort of kowtow to him, she's Missy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a little Miss. Because even though now he's the reddest of the red, you know, from
yeah.
the servant class, and now is sort of running this household, which now has all these boarders in
mm-hmm.
it, she still, to him, is yeah. this little Miss, the girl that he took care of when she was
yeah.
just a tiny, tiny girl and who he adored.
And to have her father show up.
Well, now you're really giving something away.
Oh, no, I'm not.
But yes, that there's some surprises along the way of people who pop up when you don't expect them
yeah.
to, and fortunately they pop up at the exact right moment.
Yeah. Where did you do the research? And in light of that, going there today, how much could regression come in?
Well, so how I do the research is I, of course, look on the internet. I spend a lot of time at the UCLA Research Library. I talk to a lot of scholars who have spent their lives doing research in
how
these areas.
How many years on the book?
See, I was already doing
yeah,
research for it when I was working on
yeah.
Shanghai Girls, so I could say 4 years, but
yeah.
actually 2 years once I really decided to write this. But, you know, there's a scholar down at UC Irvine who is an expert on Shanghai,
mm-hmm.
and he gave me a whole list of people to talk to, people who had escaped out of China
yeah.
and how they had escaped and what were their methods to do it. I talked to people, of course, in China. I went
yeah.
there, and I went to not only Shanghai, but also to Huangshan Village in Anhui
yeah.
Province, and stayed there for a couple of weeks
mm-hmm.
and did a lot of research there, just walking in and out of people's houses,
mm-hmm.
seeing how they made baskets and what they cooked for the baby for lunch
yeah.
and how they were washing their clothes
yeah.
and all of those things, just how people live day to day. And then it's funny, sometimes people pop up out of nowhere that really end up helping me. So I have a website and people will write to me.
Yeah.
One woman had written and said, you know, I really love Shanghai Girls and the reason is I grew up there
yeah.
When the war came, we left. And then when the war was over and after 1949, her family was German.
Yeah.
And they decided that they would come back. And because her father wanted to reopen his factory. And so they went back in about 1955 and stayed until the 1960s. Even though we tend
yeah.
to think that China was closed, it wasn't as closed as we all
yeah.
have been raised to believe. And so I would write her every day, you know, what did they have in the store windows?
Yeah.
What did they have in the shops? What did you do for cosmetics? What did you do for shampoo?
Yeah.
How did you make toast?
Yeah.
You know, in a culture that doesn't have bread, how
and
would you...
even what yeah. would you do when the red visitor
yes,
came?
The
yeah.
visit from the little red sister.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so, you know, all of those details, and especially those. Now, Did that really forward the plot? No. But how women took care of themselves and have taken care of themselves every month in China for all these thousands of years, it's pretty amazing and just, you know, incredible. Yeah. Makes me really happy we live there.
Even as to Pearl, the job she gets is being a paper picker-upper, mm-hmm. and there is her own face. Mm-hmm. That she is taken down from a wall.
Right. She's a kind of glorified trash collector.
Yeah.
But she's choosing to look at it as being a descendant of what was called the reverence for lettered paper.
Lisa, these people are so real. How did you live with them? I mean, how at the end of a day of writing about them, did you sort of close your computer up and go be normal?
No, because I just think about them all the time, and certainly there's that part towards the end where things are pretty dire,
yeah.
that I was just so consumed with all of them and what was going to happen to them and worrying about poor Joy and was Pearl going to get there in time,
yeah.
and were they going to be able to get out, you know, and how yeah. would they get out, that I was thinking about it. You know, when I'm at that stage in the book, I don't sleep very much because I'm just thinking about them all the time, mm-hmm. and actually worrying about them because
yeah.
they are very real to me.
Yeah, they are very real, including when they get there and it's the day after, what is it, switch child, eat food.
Yeah, yeah, swap child, make food. Yes, that was actually
and I
something
know that was
that
true.
People, yes, it was absolutely true. Actually, I just did an event in New York where they had, as part of my presentation, a survivor of the Great Leap Forward, and he actually talked about that
yeah.
swap child, make food. And people were so desperate. You know, you have to remember, 45 million people starved to death in 3 years
yeah.
in this period, that they were so desperate and so hungry that they would swap babies
yeah.
And then eat them.
Yeah, horrible. But one doesn't know what one would do if
right.
you were in that situation.
That's right.
You spend a lot of time there. Do you feel that they could, because it still is a dictatorship in essence, mm-hmm. that it could be a swing back if things economically went down the...
I think that's hard to imagine, although right now there is, because they're coming up on this big anniversary, there's sort of a lot of bringing back the old patriotic songs and the old patriotic plays and stories.
Yeah.
And I think there are a lot of people who are very concerned about what that could mean. You know, is that actually
yeah.
going to have this sort of swing back to the way things
yeah.
were? But the fact is that China is now a global economic superpower.
Yeah.
And I think once you have real money and once you have some of the freedoms that come with money, now this isn't real freedom, but
mm-hmm.
you do have some freedoms with money that you don't when you're absolutely
yeah.
destitute. It's very hard to go back. And
yeah.
that means, you know, among other things, that if you have money, you're going to have a television, and you
yeah.
might even have a satellite dish, and so you're seeing television that isn't state controlled,
yeah.
and you're seeing commercials that aren't state controlled, or even allowed, you know,
yeah.
but you're seeing this glimpse of the rest of the world and how other people live.
Can we also tell our friends in the audience that you have a film coming out?
Yes, Snowflower and the Secret Fan has
yeah.
been made into a film, and it will be out on July 15th. I hope everyone goes to see it.
I do too, and that it was shot in China.
In China, yes. The whole film was shot in China, and almost all of the cast is Chinese or Asian,
yeah.
Mostly from China.
Yeah.
And it's very, very, the part that's true to the book is absolutely true to the book, although they have created a modern story that wraps around the original story of Snowflower and the Secret
and
Fan.
And this book is going to be a film?
I don't know about that yet, but I just actually today heard that Peony in Love seems to be still moving forward as a film,
mm-hmm.
and that they hope to start actually filming by the end of the year.
And what's funny, I would have thought, because people don't know, you wrote murder mysteries
yes.
with a Chinese woman detective and her
right.
American husband.
Right.
The fact it went more into the esoteric work.
You know, the thing is that writing those mysteries, which take place in contemporary China, I think that that is what has helped me to write these novels today, which I think, you know, a lot of people call, you know, more literary fiction.
Yeah.
But often in literary fiction, there isn't much of a plot, not a lot happens.
Yeah.
But a lot happens in my books, and, you know, I think that people will turn the pages because they want to know what's going to happen. And in many ways, I do structure them a bit like mysteries, so that it has that pacing that will keep people going and engaged while still being able to learn a lot about the past and about culture and traditions.
What the change in life, when we were in China, it was the Directors Guild and the Writers Guild as guests of the Chinese government. And to go to any of these sort of cantons, there was the community fireplace for cooking, but there was always one little black and white
television
set.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and now you can go almost into any little house in any little village, and you will see two things: one light bulb hanging down on a string and a television.
To everybody, don't miss reading this book. Thank you, Lisa.
Thank you.
Will you autograph it? And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson.com. And you can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier. But support your local library. Go in, take out a card, and look up Lisa's other books, the ones we've been talking about, Peony, the other Snowflake, and whatever you can do, keep that library alive. There are also some other great books about China by Susan Shirk, who wrote a very good nonfiction book. Do you know her, by the way?
No, I don't.
Professor at San Diego. And when she was very young, she had a chance to meet Mao and Chang, not Chang, but his assistant.
Zhou Enlai.
Zhou Enlai, thank you. And anyhow, all those wonderful books on China. So we'll see you next time, and thank you very much, Lisa.
Thank you.